Today on the grid, it's Blind Photo Critique Day. Eric Kuna, the Kuna Man, Rocket Man, Real Man, Canahan is here. We've got some great giveaways, and it all starts in just 60 seconds.
The grid is brought to you by ProPhoto, the light shaping company. Check out the ProPhoto B1. Changing the world. Everybody has a Platypod. You should too. Go to platypod.com.
Hey everybody, welcome to the grid. I'm Scott Kelby here with my Kelby One mask. Scott, why are you wearing a mask? Because we're in Florida and this is a horrible place to be right now. It's the worst place to be probably in the world. But you know who's brave here? He's got no mask.
Here.
You know where he is? He's right here. He's right over there on the other
about 23 feet from Scott.
About 20, 25 feet away. There's Kuna. He don't care. I guess I could take mine off. He's 25 feet away. I guess we're okay.
Yeah, I think
look
we're
at this
right.
Though. Custom Kelby One mask. That's I don't know why. But we got one. Kuna, how you doing, bro?
I'm doing all right. How about you?
I'm okay.
Yeah.
We're at COVID Central in Florida.
Yeah.
Hey, I got an idea. Let's open the state. Let everybody go to bars and the beaches. It's working out great.
We're going to be talking about photography today.
But we are. We're going to talk about photography. No one can do it. Not in Florida. But, you know, other places people are doing photography.
Yeah. Well, we got
anyway,
some cool prizes today.
We do.
Yeah.
We're giving away a Leitra Torch 2.0 right here. This is a badass little, well, I shouldn't have said that.
It's cool. I mean, it is a kick butt light.
Thank you. It's a kick butt light is what it is. It's a kick butt light. We're going to give away a Slick Pick master level account. So if you want to have a professional like online portfolio all set up for you and ready to rock, we're going to give away their master level account, but we also have a deal for you too. You can get 50% off.
Yeah, everybody's a winner that's watching the show.
Yeah, yeah. If you go to slickpick.com, Kelby One, you get 50% off, which is, you know, pretty good. We're also going to give away a wonderful Platypod Max today. And you'll see their ad a little later, but it's what you use instead of a tripod because the world hates tripods. Well, not photographers, everybody else. Like the whole rest of the world hates them, but we love them. And this is like, it's like a tripod, but with only one leg. It's not even a monopod, it's just a thing. That's it, that's the one we're giving away right there. That's it, right there.
That's it, yeah.
Anyway, today is Blind Photo Critique Day, so we reached out to our viewers and said, send us in three of your images for an honest critique. They're called blind critiques because we don't know the people's names and we're not gonna reveal their names even if we did. So it's just, we can give an honest critique because we can say, here's where we're at, and just give you the straight scoop because nobody else will. So that's where we're at. But I want to talk politics first.
All right, so the way you enter the contest is you just go into the chat, you comment, you do a comment, share the post, and tell us what you don't want to win. So if you want to win the Leitra Torch, the Slick Pick Master Account, or the Platypod, just go into the comments. And let us know.
But we need to know your political affiliation and who you plan on voting for in November before you can win. Is that right?
No, that is not right.
Are you sure?
No, we're gonna stick to photography here.
Okay, last chance.
Last chance.
Okay.
I plead the fifth.
All right, so let's open up some images and get to it. Let me find some images. Hold on a second. Hey, does the control room have me? Anybody in the control room?
Yeah, he's got you.
All right. He's
yeah,
got
we got
me.
Music.
All right, let me actually get
if,
to the...
If you didn't know, Scott is actually an expert in Logic Pro as well. So,
dude,
while he's being expert in Photoshop, Lightroom, he is also an expert in Logic Pro.
My so life is Logic those, Pro.
You need any help with Logic Pro, he is a master.
Yeah, you got questions about Logic, I got you covered. Logic Pro
is amazing.
Is the Photoshop of audio.
It is amazing for audio.
And it's got depth like yeah. you cannot believe.
That's what's so cool about it is like that's you can do anything in it. It's like Photoshop. It's exactly it. It's
and so you know what I'm getting for my birthday?
Audio. What's that?
More plugins for Logic Pro. Go. Like everybody's asking me like, what do you want for your birthday? Here's the here's the next plugin in my list. All right, sorry, I'm having a little hard time. I kind of messed something up here. Just give me 1 second. There we go. All right. Let's start with this puppy. Now, Eric's giving us a 3-minute timer so we don't go
yes,
over
I
and
am.
Do crazy
Let me
stuff.
Grab the sophisticated 3-minute timer.
And why won't my what's going on here?
There oh, it is. Already set up from last time.
There's weird stuff going on. All right. Okay. All right. All right. You guys ready to go?
Yeah, let's do this.
All right. So 3 images. Here we go. Here's our first one. Can you see these, Eric, where you are?
I can.
Okay, good.
I can already tell you one thing.
I know. I know what you're going to say.
Nice chin.
All right. Well, I know what Eric's thinking about this one because we got a serious lighting problem here.
Yeah. I mean, it's a beautifully lit chin.
Yeah. But here's the thing. You created, it's like the mortal sin of portraits. You underlit your subject. So here's what I believe is happening. I believe you have a friend holding a reflector and uplighting your subject. So the sun is behind them. Look at his hair is lit, right?
Yeah, and it's evident by the catch light in the eyes.
Yeah, so you have a friend holding a reflector in the exact place you were never, ever, ever. Well, in one rare exception.
There were one exception. There's if you one. Want to look menacing, a horror.
Yeah, if you want them to look mean or something.
Yes, light somebody from underneath. If you want them to look not very
want them to
mean,
look aggressive. Like if you
aggressive.
Were, well, think about this. This will really help you to understand. If you were going to do a Halloween thing, what do? You take a flashlight and you hold it under your chin and you uplight yourself to look creepy. That's what you did to this guy. You underlit him. And you might do that for an athlete that you're trying to, like, they're gritting their teeth, like, ah, you might underlight them to make them look aggressive.
Yeah. Maybe, yeah.
Yeah, but you do not underlight. Now, there is a situation where you're lighting something, like, your main light is something else, okay? So your main light is a strobe or something, and then you're using a white reflector, not a silver one like you're using here, a white one to bounce some light into their eyes and in their chin to just lessen the shadows. You might do that in a particular case. That is not the case of what's happening here because there's only one light on your subject because you can look in his eyes and see. So you have a lighting problem. Now, believe it or not, you also have a lighting problem here. It's not terrible because they're not in direct light, but you didn't quite angle them right to where the light, like look at the light, it's hitting her nose. You have a highlight on her nose. That's not an awesome place to have like that highlight peeking through. And you could have just rearranged their bodies to where they
the light is soft enough that he could have just moved it a little bit.
Yeah, it would just be positioning them just a little better. Like you have nice lights on the side of his face here. And then over here, you got some just peeking on her nose. It would be just positioning them a little bit better, I think.
It's a lot better than the first one.
It's miles ahead of the first one.
Days and weeks and months ahead
now,
of time.
This last shot, very nice.
Yeah.
That's a very nice shot. Like it's very nice post-processing. It's just a nice shot, good leading lines. It's all good. We have nothing bad to say about that
one.
Yeah,
I want to go to that.
Don't ever show anyone this shot of creepy guy. Now, if this guy's a serial killer, it's lit correctly.
Yeah, if it was like for like a poster of a show and it was like serial killer.
Serial killer tonight. All right, so that's our first one and it didn't go well. Well, it didn't go horribly. It didn't go horribly.
Just don't do that uplighting.
Yeah, that uplighting thing is not awesome.
It's a one trick.
All right, let's see where else we got. Let's take a look here. Here we go. You got the timer going?
Oh, we actually didn't even meet the other one. All right, go.
Here we go. We got sports shots. All right. Overall, not good. I'm sorry. So, first of all, we'll just start here. This is a shot of a referee's butt. You know what every sport fan wants to see? A shot of a referee's butt.
Not that shot. I know what you're going for. You're going for the slow shutter of everybody moving and the referee still. But yeah, it's just not. It's
good.
A terrible angle. The referee.
It's all bad.
There's not really much happening too. It's not like yeah.
Yeah. Every once in a while, you'll see someone pull off a referee shot where the referee is key to it, like some amazing thing is happening,
yeah.
And you can see that the ref is locked on and his eyes are like, wow, is he going to make the catch or not? You've seen some. It's rare, but you do occasionally see a really great shot where the referee is part of the shot. This is not one of them, unfortunately. Then you have this shot where the referee is basically talking to the quarterback. And so it's not an action shot.
Mm-mm.
This is the shot that happens before the action. What are we looking for in a great sports shot? We're looking for the peak moment of action. This is as far from the peak moment of action as you can get. Now, you also have shots that tell a story. The story is the play's about to start, and he said, hold on for 2 seconds, I got to get the ball placed. Who knows what he's saying, but it's just... He's not yelling at him. There's no big gesture. There's nothing going on. You know, it's just kind of a nothing shot. Now, from a technical standpoint, you've nailed it.
Yeah, so far we haven't talked about the technical. I mean, the technical execution is fine.
Background's
and
out
even
of
the
focus.
Like the last shot. I mean, you were technically executing a slow shutter speed with the subject and
But I would say this: if you were really trying to communicate what's going on here, why is this guy in the shot? Why is this guy in the shot? If you're really trying to communicate what's going on between these two, why are these other people in here? All right, I got to go find the crop tool now because they moved it. All right, here it is. If that was the case, your shot, hang on, trying to figure out this is the new user interface for Camera Raw, and apparently this is the first time I've tried to crop in it. your story is in there, but it's a little higher. Hey, I'm starting not to like this. All right, there's where your story is, somewhere in there. Oh, nice. That's nice. That's no
beautiful.
Bug. That's where the story is, right there. Why am I seeing all these other players and stuff? All right, just 10 seconds on the last shot. Yep. I'm sorry, we ran a bit over. And then you have another shot of a ref. Now, maybe
your like ref
is the
hired
husband
you.
Or...
you know, like
I
the ref
know.
Was like, get
there's,
shots,
you got a ref
shots
thing.
Of me.
But again... This isn't a ref screaming, yelling, fighting with the coach. I've seen some shots where the ref is screaming at the coach that are really interesting. This isn't. This is nothing. It's just, I'm sorry. So forget about the technical. You got that down. Start making interesting photos.
You know,
these
the other thing is if you're shooting football, just worry about two eyes and a ball for a little bit. And that, like, do the cliche, just I'm going to follow the ball. And I'm going to get their eyes in the ball and try that for a little bit.
But you know what, though? There's three shots with a ref.
That's what I'm saying. It's,
is it the same ref?
No, it's not. I don't think so.
I just got to wonder. Maybe you're hired to photograph
Maybe.
The refs. But if you are, you're taking boring shots of refs.
Yeah, there's more in the peak action.
All right, you got category. Some work to do. All right, let's roll on.
All right.
Here we go. Three shots. Let's see them. Well, these are nice.
Mm-hmm.
These are just very nice all the way around. I like the
post-processing.
Look at the leading lines on this sucker.
Yeah.
Like this one compositionally is really nicely done, and you've got everything coming together. You got a great sky. You have this path. And
the path leads you down right to the lighthouse.
Yep, and it leads you to another path that leads you to the lighthouse, and you've got that nice bright spot down there. This is just a very nicely composed and put together shot.
You definitely want to be there. That's where the shot does. It wants you to walk.
Yeah, I'd love to be there.
It leads you down those steps. You want to be walking down those steps.
This is the least of the three. It's nice, but it is lacking
nice
what these other ones are have.
It's It's great on those on the other two landscapes. They have great layers.
Yeah.
So they have a foreground layer, a middle ground layer, a background layer. There's a lot going on there.
Yeah, this one technically has a foreground here, but it's not an interesting foreground.
It's not crazy, but it's still there.
But it's still a nice shot. It's just like compared to the other two are really good.
Right time of day, they're using lighting at the right time of day. That's why that's really the colors are popping. You got those soft shadows and highlights.
Yeah, these are, keep doing what you're doing. You're doing a great job. Your stuff looks very, very nice. Very, very marketable, very nice looking. Yep. This kind of stuff you'd love to hang on your walls. All right, coming up next, we've got, of course, giveaways coming up. So make sure that you enter the contest by just leaving us a comment. And we're going to be looking at a whole bunch of more images coming up next. So stick around right here on the political episode of The Grid.
Bonjour, mesdames et messieurs. My name is Serge Romney. I'm a French photographer living in Los Angeles, California, and I love to do fine art photography. I got lucky because I have a deal with a great German publisher. I've done 7 big coffee table books, and my work is in over 75 galleries around the world. In fact, I got the deal of the books because I had a great portfolio and I use SlickPick for my portfolio. I switched to SlickPick because they have incredible hosting service where you can put all my photos offline. They also have incredible album sharing with privacy settings I have seen nowhere else. And so many incredible features. What's amazing about SlickPick, it's a technology to make website, but for photographer. They don't do any other job. They specialize in photography. In the past, I have personally spent thousands and thousands of dollars getting a professional designer to redo my website. With SlickPix, they're throwing the design service in for free. For the same price, you'd have to pay for hosting. With an annual fee of less than $180, which translates to less than $15 per month, which is the price of even like hosting a WordPress website, you can get a professional designer to design your website. It's crazy. So all you have to do is click the link below and get the offer. You will get this special price, which is 50% off for the first year, but you're gonna get it for life. So get it now. I love my SlickPick website. I love the business that it drives me, and I want the same success for you. Get it now.
Would you believe us if we told you that you could fit studio lighting in your pocket? Well, Lytra has made it possible. Lytra is a global award-winning brand that designs and manufactures professional-grade camera lights that are compact, rugged, and waterproof. Whether you're using Lytra gear in a photo studio or underwater, Lytra's mission is to provide content creators with flexible and unlimited lighting tools that can mount on any camera, anywhere. Their lights come with a high CRI or color rendering index, making them some of the most color-accurate lights in the industry. Due to the light's compact and rugged design, photographers are able to use the lights in ways that their studio lighting never could. Lytra has also made multiple lighting accessories available to fit your every need as a creator. Whether you're shooting portraits, nailing a product shot, or even flying your drone, they have got you covered. Lytra enables photographers and filmmakers to focus on their craft and create something beautiful. What will you create?
Talk to anybody.
This segment of The Grid is brought to you by B&H Photo, the professional source since 1973.
Back to you. Hey, we're back. Hey, did you see that Lytra commercial?
Yeah, I did.
I have one, and I got a bunch of the accessories.
Yep.
Oh my gosh, it's just the coolest little light. And look how cool the people were that were shooting it.
I know, right?
It makes you young and cool, so that's why I use it. It's working great for me.
I'll tell you, those barn doors, and now you can focus in the light and all that stuff, and even they got the softbox attachment.
Oh, dude, it's amazing the things they have for it.
And really, honestly, nowadays, you know, we still use strobes, and the strobes are nice, but you can with how sensitive and how clean the ISOs are on cameras.
Oh, yeah.
That you can really sculpt light with these little lights and these little attachments now and really create awesome portraits and awesome pictures.
And you know what's awesome? What? Somebody watching right now is going to win one of those today.
Yeah.
You want to say hi to some people that are watching
right
now?
And speaking of people that are watching, we have people all over the world. The first one, we got Ratna from Holland saying hi. So we got Mike saying hi. Scott, love the Blind Photo Critiques. You did one of his a few years ago and helped me immensely.
Sweet.
So, Elizabeth saying hi from Florida. Stanley saying hi from Bowie, Maryland. We got Pai saying hi from Myanmar.
Ooh,
wow,
yay.
that is some
distance
right
Myanmar.
There. That might be all the way opposite on the. I mean, that's pretty close to all the way on the other
opposite
side.
Opposite from where we are.
Yeah. Susan saying thanks for keeping Eric safe, Scott. So there you go. Then we got Little Herman saying hi from New Hampshire. This is becoming a habit. So Tori saying hi from sitting at my desk at work, trying to work and listen and watch. So we got Pernell from Denmark, Nilo from Dubai. We got Greg joining from Mesa, Arizona. Christy from Sicily. So we got people all over the world tuning into the grid. So,
all right. Hey, keeping Eric Kuna safe is a top priority. So he's not just a host and a great rocket photographer, but also Eric runs the show here, right? So I do my education and stuff and all, but Eric has to make sure that everything that I come up with actually gets done. So he works with the web department and he works with the marketing teams and works with everybody. So
hey, you know, speaking,
Eric even gets a cold, we all go freaking
speaking
out.
Speaking of new things to get done, we have that new exciting conference that we have coming up next
month. We do.
Month.
I guess I could take my mask off.
Oh yeah, that's a good one.
I love when I do
that's
that. It always gets stuck in my glasses. So coming up here, July 14th and 15th, guys, I got to tell you, the registration for this event is exploding.
Yeah,
it is amazing.
I'll tell you what, Scott. So we talked about this because, again, you know, like I said, we do a lot of this planning. You came up with this idea. We all came up, but you came up with like the curriculum and the idea. And I looked at the schedule and I was like, I want to go to this thing. Like that's really how I judge it is like, do I want to actually go to this? And it's like, wow, this whole schedule is just packed with awesome,
the classes are
awesome
amazing.
Classes.
The classes
yeah.
and the instructors are absolutely top notch. And yeah. you're right. There's classes I'm going to watch that are on there. And plus,
absolutely.
Now, of course, the whole thing broadcasts live. So we're not running a bunch of taped classes or thing. These are actual. It's all live. We've got Q&As with the instructors. And if you're like not that good at Photoshop yet, you're like, I'm just kind of a beginner. You get to come the day before the conference where I'm going to give you a crash course on Photoshop to get you up to speed so that the next few days will really help.
And I thought that was an awesome idea. That was your idea where we were thinking like, hey, maybe, you know, there's a lot of Lightroom users that don't really use Photoshop, but man, Photoshop's where the magic happens. So yeah. that first day is kind of just that thing that lets you, you know, kind of like know about like the basics of Photoshop. And how you can, you know, use it.
Hey, we have a little video that I did. Can we run that? I just did this little video that explains it. Can we run it real quick just so you guys can see, and then we'll get right back to the critique. So if you guys in the control room have that, if you could run it, that would be awesome.
I've got a question for you. What would your creative life be like if you were really good at Photoshop? I mean, imagine the things that you could do, the images you'd be able to create. Everybody wants to learn Photoshop because it's the pro's tool. It's their secret weapon. And you can do anything with Photoshop. And when I'm out there teaching, one of the most common things I hear is, you know, yeah, I would love to get good at Photoshop. I mean, I use it now and then, but I'm just not that really sure what I'm doing. I also hear from people who do use Photoshop pretty regularly, but they're kind of stuck at a plateau of learning. And if they just had some time to dig in and really learn the latest stuff, they know how it would change everything for them. What if, in just 2 days, you could really unlock the power of Photoshop? You could take a big leap forward in your skills and start doing those things in Photoshop that you've only dreamed of. If you had the right instructors and your choice of classes, and you could do this all from home in your own environment where you're already comfortable and you have everything you need, there's no telling how far you could go in just that short time. Well, now that we actually have the time, we've got a way for you to supercharge your Photoshop skills and take things to the next level in just 2 days. It's a totally live, online, interactive learning experience produced and hosted by the folks who bring you Photoshop User Magazine. We're the same people who've been producing the annual Photoshop World Conference since back in the 1990s. And today, we're launching a new live Photoshop online learning experience, and we want you to be a part of it. Come and join us for the Kelby One Photoshop Conference. It's a live 2-day multi-track conference and it's delivered completely online. So no matter where you are in the world, you can be a part of it. We brought together some of the best Photoshop instructors in the world, including trainers like Terry White, Serge Romilly, Mark Heaps, Adobe's own Brian O'Neill Hughes, Tracy Sweeney, Glenn Dewis, Victoria Pavlov, along with the editor of Photoshop User Magazine and the author of the best-selling book, How Do I Do That in Photoshop? That's me, by the way. Anyway, you're going to learn a lot about Photoshop. You're going to learn more about Photoshop in 2 days than you ever thought you could. This is accelerated learning, but it's presented in a way that makes it fast and easy to learn. You can so do this, and we're there to make sure you can. Plus, you'll have exclusive on-demand access to the entire conference afterward, so you can go back and rewatch any session again or the sessions that you might have missed during the entire two-day event. So, what if you're brand new to Photoshop? Then you can come and join us the day before the conference for a Photoshop crash course to get you up and running fast so you can feel comfortable during the event. It's short, sweet, and to the point, but it will get you comfortable with how Photoshop works so you can make the most of the next 2 days. Plus, we have classes for beginners during the conference that will get you using Photoshop like a pro in no time. We'll also have late night sessions on the best Photoshop plugins, one-on-one Q&A sessions with our instructors, and lots of fun and surprises along the way. Best of all, we've made this entire conference super affordable, so anybody, anywhere can join in. So come spend a few days with us, focusing on something really positive, on being creative, on growing your skills, and getting totally immersed in learning, laughing, and supercharging your Photoshop skills. You can sign up right now for the Photoshop Conference at kelby1live.com, and we'll see you July 14th and 15th, 2020, as the world's best come together for this unique Photoshop learning experience. We'll see you there.
I got it.
All right. Hey, so that's it. Where do they go, Eric, to sign up?
So they go to Kelby One Live. So if they go to kelby1live.com, they can actually go directly there if they go to kelby1live.com/Photoshop-conference. Or if you just go to Kelby One Live, it's right up in the corner. Yeah. It says Photoshop Conference. You click on it. You go to the Photoshop Conference.
There you go. All right. Let's get back to our critiques.
Yeah.
Here we go.
Flying critiques.
So let's take a look at this next one here. We got three
All
shots.
Right.
One.
All right.
Two. Three. Okay,
so photos of other people's stuff.
That's the problem. You're taking photos of other people's art.
Yeah.
You're not really making your own art. You're just showing other people's art. You're like, here's a great sculpture. Here's another great sculpture. Here's another great sculpture. Those artists are really great.
You're like documenting. It's documenting. It's photojournalism.
And it's not like, because I've seen some people do a picture of like a modern sculpture that's really interesting or anything. These are like snapshots.
Yeah, you're not taking it in the best light, right?
You're not taking them in great light. You're not showing interesting angles. It's, you know, you got a tree growing out of her head. The background's all in focus, so it's just kind of a messy shot. This is the best of the three because of the low angle, but of course your horizon
line is
crooked.
The eagle is flying and crooked.
So I think you need a new topic. I just think you straight up need a new topic. Don't photograph other people. Why don't you just go take a picture of the most Mona Lisa? Because that's somebody else painted that too, and then show a picture of that. It's just,
but again, if you scroll through them, I mean, I'm sure the histogram looks okay. I'm sure the camera took good exposures and all that stuff. It's just there's not a photo there, especially in that middle one. I mean, the first one probably might have the best.
Yeah, this one's the worst for sure.
Yeah, the middle one's just there's just nothing there.
Yeah, you need to rethink what you're shooting.
That one, yeah.
And then, I mean, if you are going to shoot these monuments, you got to find a way to show them in a way that just doesn't show, yep, there's the monument in the park. It's like, you got a lot of work to do here.
Yes.
And I think it would be starting with reevaluating what you're
shooting. Sorry, we're just being honest here.
I'm not going to try to be mean. It was just like, and we're not showing your name, so we're not like embarrassing you because you don't know, nobody knows who you are, but the person's name is Bob Johnson. No, just kidding. I have no idea who it is. Literally, I have no idea whatsoever. All right, let's take a look here. Here we go. Right. I I like what you're trying to do.
I mean, that's what I was going to say. There's good bones here. There's good foundation.
There's good bones.
Something to work with here.
I like what you're trying to do. You're just not quite nailing it. But I think that you're on a path.
Oh yeah, very close.
So you're on the right path. I like what you're trying to do. There's good stuff here. You just need to keep doing it. Can I give you a quick story real quick? This is just a quick side. We don't really need to go through these in one by one because they're all in the ballpark. But this is a story from Joel Grimes. So Joel Grimes is a Kelby One instructor, just a great guy, really super nice person, very, very smart photographer. He was doing a workshop on compositing. And one of the students just really had a gift for it, really good. And he comes up and he shows Joel a composite that he made. And Joel's like, hey, you know what? This is like one of your first composites. This is fantastic. This looks really good. Now go do that 300 more times. And that really nails it. Like, you're on the right path. You're going in the right direction. Path. You're not quite there yet, but I like what you're trying to do and I like where you're going. So I would just say to you, and I can't give you particulars, you know what I mean? It's not like, I mean.
Well, I think they're trying to sculpt the light and kind of shape the light and doing stuff like that.
And you're trying to do these fantasy kind of looks.
Yeah, I mean, you're definitely on the path. I mean, there's little things like.
You're close.
Like the last one, there's little framing and then lighting issue, hot spots.
But I think that's all going to go away.
Yeah, as you go,
because your other stuff is nicely lit and stuff.
Yeah,
and
I mean, you're definitely.
I like where you're going. Just keep going with what
there's
you're
something
doing.
The middle one speaks to me the most. Like,
This one.
I actually like this one.
The best one.
Yeah,
hands down.
That's what I'm saying. Is that one speaks the most? But again, it's so close to the others. You're on the path.
Yeah. So I would just say, just keep doing what you're doing and you're gonna keep evolving and getting better. Just do it 300 more times and mm-hmm. you'll be there. But and I say that lightly, but it's like, I think you got a lot of potential and I think you're on your way. Stay on this path and keep doing it. And also another thing that will really help you is to study the work of other photographers that are doing this kind of stuff. You know who's good at this? What's his name? JD?
You're going to have to help me. I mean, I'm not a portrait.
Oh, come on. He does the big flowy dress stuff so well. Oh, any other? JD Sally. S-A-L-L-E-E. And it's either Sally or Sally. Go look his work up, and you will see a lot of really neat stuff. And he does this style of stuff, and he does it at an expert level. So go check his stuff out. But hey, I feel like you're on the path, and it's good to be on the path. Here we go. I think we're 2 out of 3 here.
Yeah.
I think this first one's nice. I love the way you've got the groom's jacket and the flower. But while the couple's out of focus, they're not so out of focus that you're not telling the story. This is kind of nice. I think it's a nice little device, and that's what it is.
Yeah, right? Definitely. I mean, it's nice, and people would like it.
I don't know if you need all of this tree and all of that stuff. You know, you could probably crop this tighter and make the image a little stronger. I'm afraid to go to Camera Raw because I'm so bad at the new tool. I don't know. I got to figure out how. Maybe I just need to hit the unlock, and that'll help. There we go. So the story's in here. And it'll just be stronger if that was your message. You don't need that whole tree. We get it. There's a tree.
Yeah, well, and that helps too with bringing the jacket more prominent in the frame, so you do see that that's a jacket with the flower and stuff.
All of that. This is the least one. Now I got to tell you,
you're not a selective color person.
Yeah, this is a kind of a cliche thing to do, which is, and I'm going to tell you right now, I've included it in some of my Photoshop books because people want to do it. But the day of this has passed in a big, big way. Yeah. And so the selective color thing, photographically, is not awesome. I like the message. I'm not crazy about the you know, I know you're trying to pull out the flag and all, but
yeah, anyway. I mean, I like it. I like it. I like selective color. I mean, not crazy about it, but I like it. I mean,
it actually fairly works here, but
I mean, it's a good use of it. Put it that way.
You know
way.
What I'd rather see? I would rather see a light tint of everybody instead of black and white.
Yeah, that'd
like
be
a
nice.
Light, like if they were all kind of pastel.
You could probably
you
even come in a little
colorful,
tighter.
Right.
You could come in a little tighter.
Yeah,
too.
You could come in tighter too. Yeah. But that's not a bad shot. And this one's very nice.
Yeah.
It's got everything going for it. You know, it's nice. The tree isn't distracting. The time of day is right. You got the sun on the touch of the mountain.
Post processing's not.
Yeah,
too
this
much.
Is this on the money. So you're obviously very accomplished. You're doing a good job. Keep doing what you're doing.
Yeah.
We're being picky about the selective color thing, but you know.
Yeah.
It's still a good it's a good shot without
it's
it.
A good shot.
I guess that's what my point is. It's a good shot without it.
Yeah, I think you would have liked it more if it wasn't selective color.
Like, yeah, if you didn't have the selective color, I'd be like, man, that's a cool
but
shot.
But I think that's where you're going with kind of adding, maybe saturating the other parts of the image just a little bit.
Yeah.
So you've got a little bit of saturation, but then a really big vibrance there with those
So if the flag's at 100%, the crowd's at 25%.
Yeah,
not
I think
black
that's what
and
you
white.
Were going
anyway,
for, yeah.
But still, I hate to be picky because you're doing a good job.
All
you're
right.
getting it done. All right, here we go. Three more.
All right.
If I had to choose a word, it would be yikes.
Yeah, I was like, I don't. Yeah.
All right. I'm so these
sorry.
Are they're. This is a snapshot. This is taken at a car show. It's crooked as anything.
Crooked.
You don't
see the
bottom
of the wheels.
I know what you're trying to do.
You don't see something. There's not anything to. There's no subject. I mean, the car is the subject, but it's shot in a way that like.
Yeah, it's funky. Look.
It just looks funky.
It is very, very challenging shooting at a car show.
Yes.
I've done it.
Yes.
You have to do it to where you don't see it's taken at a car show. So you would have to crop this image in a way where you don't see the other cars, but what's killing you is the reflection on the car. Now, I know what you're saying. Scott, the problem is the car show closed at 5 p.m. I couldn't get good light.
Of course
I couldn't
it
get nice
That's
reflection.
That's what they do. They make
yeah,
it close.
Yeah, but sometimes, I see car shows here in town that are at dusk.
Yes.
And I think, ooh, I'd like to stop by there and shoot that. Never have my camera with me when I do, except for my iPhone.
And then there's that big hot spot where... in front of the car where it's like that's the brightest part.
Well, there's one here and there's one here.
Or on the ground I'm talking about on the front.
All right, over here. You did a long exposure, but it's just a mess. I'm not sure where I'm supposed to look.
Kinda,
do I look here?
Unfortunately,
look here?
The way the water is and the way that,
now,
that swirls, doesn't that, it kind of looks like a cesspool. Or
it looks like a cesspool.
It looks like it's like
your
a
shot
a draining
looks
like,
sewage. Like a cesspool, but is there a shot inside of here?
Probably.
That would be
probably
better. Now, if you'd have turned in this, we wouldn't be saying it looks like a cesspool.
Sorry, that's what came to my mind.
Cesspool.
Cesspool. It kind of looks like, toxic waste or something, like draining into a
toxic waste pool. So, this part isn't bad.
But you know,
I would get rid of some
exposure.
Of these leaves, and it's just kind of messy. And then the last one... just a it's a snapshot. They're basically all snapshots.
I was in a pretty place and I wanted to capture it.
I was here and I was walking along a trail. I took out my iPhone and took a shot. That's where we were standing.
You can't see the bottom. You can't, there's no placement of the foreground in the ground. It's just there. And then you've got like the prominent tree is all crooked and looking craziness.
Yeah.
And then
in short, keep working.
Yeah.
They're not terrible. Well, the cesspool shot's pretty bad.
I mean, hey, again, the histogram probably looks beautiful.
Yeah. Now the car show thing is tough, but the goal of the car show is not to show the car show. All right, moving on. All right. I really like this shot because it looks like a movie set.
So of the three, that's my favorite. Definitely.
It's my favorite too because it's got a cinematic style cropping.
Yes.
And it looks like they were we were on the movie set and they were driving these cattle. There's cattle? No, they're horses. We're driving these horses down.
Yeah. I mean, it's.
Give me a western town down to Cheyenne.
Yeah, we're going to Tombstone.
Going to Tombstone with the horses.
Going into Tombstone. However,
I like that.
There is a road over to the left.
And you know
there.
What's cool? Like the dust kicking up from the horses, silhouettes the horses nightly. This is actually fairly nicely done because it's so obvious it's a horse.
Yep.
You know, and only thing I might do here is, I don't know if the background needs to be that bright. You could make it a little more orangey and a little darker, I think might help the shot. Let's go see. If we made it darker and made it more orangey.
I'm liking
and
it better.
Darker and more orangey. And let's go see, where's the split? I don't know where anything is in the new one. There we go. I think it would look a little, see the on the right is the after.
Yep.
Just make it a little darker, a little more orangey, I think would make it a little stronger. It gets warmer is better, but I don't know. So, and then the last one, meh. The lighting's kind of harsh. Look at the shadow here on the bud.
Harsh light.
Very harsh light. I think this would probably look.
Harsh light is technically, I mean, harsh light usually doesn't look great on a flower.
Doesn't look great on anything.
It doesn't look great on anything. Exactly. Well, there's times when you could use
harsh
light.
No, you want to do an athlete or something. Yeah.
Yeah, not
this. But go around the other side of the flower to where it's backlit, where the good shot probably was.
Yeah.
The other two, I like where you're going. This one,
all right.
This one needs some work. All right. Hey, coming up next, we've got, of course, some more prizes. If you haven't entered to win a prize, just leave us a comment. Just say anything. But let us know what you want to win. Say, hey, Lytra, love that platypod. Want to win?
What was our other? Pick.
Hey, I didn't give away a book or anything. Oh, can I give away a book?
Yeah. We'll add a book.
All right. I'm going to show you what it is, too, because I got a brand new book. The ebook just came out. The ebook is out. But I want to show you, where is my book? I got to get a picture of it, because if you don't see a picture, it's not real.
It's coming.
I'm working on it. I'm very close. Got to find the folder for it.
You're even working on another book right now.
Yeah, I know. I'll do another book. That's what we do. We do books. Where the heck is it?
So we got the Lytra, we got the Slick Pick, we got the Platypod, and now we have a book from Scott, which
Where's the dang cover? Hang on.
Probably over there on the counter.
I'm looking.
Yeah, there's Slick Pick. If you go to slickpick.com/Kelby1, you can get 50% off Slick Pick. Everybody wins on the grid.
Well, you know what I could do to speed this process up? I'm going to go to Amazon and just show you it. Hang on.
Or we can take a break, and when we come back from break, we'll announce what the book is that you're going to win.
Here it is. I found it.
All right,
I'm on Amazon.
It.
This is it. All right. So this is the brand new version of my digital photography book. You know the one that is the best-selling book on digital photography in history?
Yep.
But the last time I updated it was 7 years ago. And I've learned a whole lot in 7 years, so I basically went back, looked at the whole book. I thought I was just going to update it. I wound up almost rewriting all of it. It's a major, major update to the book. And that's the cover right there that you can see. And the paperback is coming soon. Now, it says over here it's going to be released in September. It's on the printing press right now, but Amazon...
Well, they always do that.
Amazon chooses like some crazy far-out date because they don't know when it's really going to show up. But I can tell you, it is on press right now. I'm thinking it's going to ship in July, not September.
Yeah.
But anyway...
They usually do that.
Yeah, they do.
But what I love about that book is it's one of those where, you know, I don't know if you can get to the pages, but it's one concept, one page, so it's very easily digestible, especially somebody who's starting out with digital photography or just needing a refresher on digital photography. It's a great thing because you're picking up those tips and those tricks in a very quick easy way of doing it. And that's why we've had millions of people buy the book.
Yeah, so. And it's translated into every language you can think of. Literally, it's in Korean, it's in Russian, it's in Hebrew, it's in every language you can think of. And it's brand new. You can go get the ebook right now, or you can wait and get the print book. But either way, we're going to give away the ebook today because we can do it. In yep. fact, I'm going to give away 5 copies of the Ooh. Ebook today. You got to let me know you want the book, though. You got to say in the comments, I want the book. And I'm going to give away 5 of them today. So 5 of them to people in the forum. Because I know that because Kim said I could give away 5 All at right. any time. So I'm
there
doing
we go.
It. I'm doing it today. 5 copies.
5 copies.
All right. So when we come back, we're going to do more stuff. More
Is
images.
Is the tripod dead? Sure, a tripod works for basic shots, but who wants to be basic? You don't need basic. You need Blockbuster. And that's a job for a platypod. The platypod is your go-anywhere, do-anything flat tripod base. Its compact design helps you discover unique angles that you could never reach with a typical tripod. So, whether you're bringing up baby, driving Miss Daisy, or with your beasts of the southern wild, you can capture big budget footage and stills for a fraction of the time and money. So go ahead, shoot the next Rocky or Birdman. Or on the waterfront, the platypod is equipped to grip uneven surfaces and hang from just about anything. When tripods go low, the platypod goes lower. Its flat base reaches the lowest possible angle, resulting in truly inventive shots that can't be replicated with traditional equipment. And if you feel like adding a dramatic overhead angle, the platypod has you covered. Just strap it or screw it in, and you're ready to go within minutes. The platypod is constructed from aircraft-grade aluminum and titanium. Yeah, the stuff Air Force One is made of. So it's durable enough to travel with you from Chinatown to Casablanca and everywhere in between. If you only take the tripod, the story ends. You wake up the next morning with nothing but basic footage. Or you could take the platypod to a museum, or on an elevator, or strap it to a tree. Or hanging on a bench at church, or put it on the ground and get incredible Blockbuster footage. Who are we kidding? You should totally take the platypod. The tripod is not dead, but it needs a sidekick, the platypod.
Hey there, my name is Brett Malley. I'm a Kelby One instructor and Adobe Press author. If you've been wondering what more you can do with your landscapes, take a look at my latest class on landscape compositing. In this class, I cover everything from how to change out your background, how to bring in a foreground and a subject, and even changing lighting and atmosphere. So if you've ever wondered how to do landscape compositing, now's your chance right here on Kelby One. Check it out.
Photographers, if you're like me, you wind up having to do a lot of your own retouching. You don't have the great benefit of being able to send your stuff off to a professional retoucher who does all the work for you. No, you got to do it yourself. And if you're in that case and you're sitting there thinking, how do I remove sweaty hot spots, or how do I change somebody's eye color? How do I reduce some jowls, or how do I remove stubble or wrinkles out of clothes, or how do I add catch lights? How do I trim eyebrows, any of that stuff? Man, if I got a class for you. I wanted to do a portrait retouching class that's quick and that's easy, and that you could go right to the thing you wanted to do, and I get right to the point and I show you just really quick how to do it. So if you're a photographer and you need to know to retouch, man, have I got you covered. It's called 25 Quick and Easy Portrait Retouching Techniques, and it's only found one place right here at kelby1.com.
This segment of The Grid is brought to you by Canon.
Hey, we're back. Let's hit it.
Let's All right, go let's on do to it.
Let's go on to somebody else. Here we go.
All right.
Un.
Start.
Du. Toi. Well, these are nice overall.
They're nice.
I like this this shot. The only problem is, to make this shot stronger, and you should, it's a nice shot, is you have the nose of the plane right at the edge of the image.
I was going to say the same thing.
So
it's you have no room, no breathing room.
Yeah, you have no breathing room. When you don't have room for the plane to go into, it is a subconscious effect, but it makes people uncomfortable with your photo. It literally makes them uncomfortable. So That's the problem. You need another like 2 inches.
If something should be moving, you need room for it to move.
Whether it's an
into.
Athlete, yeah, or it's an animal.
Rocket, I deal with that with
a
rockets.
Rocket, yeah, you gotta anything. Leave room for yeah, athlete, imagine if this sports. Was a rocket and the tip of the rocket was right
yeah,
here.
It just wouldn't it, you'd it, be like it needs to travel somewhere.
Yeah,
if
it needs
you
to travel.
Show the whole thing, it needs to travel.
It's sharp, it's a cool shot, and I love the Belgian Air Force. However, this one, unfortunately, so I like what you're trying to do. It's cool that you had access to this, but the planes aren't, you didn't angle it to where the planes look symmetrical. Like they're all kind of different. And I'm not sure if there was something that you could do as a photographer to get them looking more, but look at the difference distance between this plane and the nose of that one. Then it's real short, real short, real short. These are pretty good down here. But if you could have positioned yourself to where this nose was further that way, it would have been better. It may not have been possible, but it's unfortunately not an awesome shot.
Where that might have been possible is if you had a long lens and got back and then added that compression.
Yeah, if you did some compression. Eric's right. Yep. If you did some compression. This is nice. It's nice. I like the engine detail. I'm not digging the clouds in the background. It actually is kind of distracting, which is weird. I'd almost rather see this with a clear blue sky kind of background, but this isn't bad. They're all good. Don't get me wrong. They're all good. This is the least of them, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And I know that you obviously had some pretty good access to this or a great shooting or vantage point. So I know that you're psyched about it. It's just not a good photo. This is a good photo that needs some space. Now, by the way, you can get space. So let's just see how easy or hard it will be. Let's add some canvas size to this.
In Photoshop.
Yeah, in Photoshop. Photoshop's really, really, it's good.
Yeah, it's awesome.
I went the wrong way.
Oh, wrong way.
Nice.
No. Don't do
nice.
That.
Nice.
Don't do that.
Okay, two do inches that. Is more than you need. All right, just give me one. I know I'm going over.
Yep.
That's more than you need. You only need about that.
Yep.
All right, now, I don't know if this is going to work. I'm skeptical, personally. Let's duplicate
the layer.
You never
know.
I'm going to try content aware scale.
Oh, it's having a hard time. It's like, nope.
Yeah, it's like, no.
No,
well, you
I
would really
this.
Do it from here. Hold on. And then you would choose content aware scale. Let's try that.
Aha. It's coming.
It's not real.
Yeah,
it's stretching
not
the plane.
Doing a great job.
All right, no.
You
so here's
the plane.
You'd have to do it the old school way. Oh, let me deselect this. Old school way is you're going to have to somehow stretch this to fill that area. Oh, boy, that didn't work well at all, did it? Come
yeah,
on.
No.
Why won't it let me hit that?
I think because you're not getting the right. Yeah, there you go.
You got to fill that space. Now, that's not going to do it. But you're going to have to go old school, get the clone stamp tool, set it to normal. Well, wait a minute. What about content aware fill? And the content aware fill is not going to get it done, is it?
You never know. It's always something to try.
But you know you can do it old school.
Oh yeah.
Right, hang on.
You can always do it old school.
Ain't no school like the old school. Oh man, why can't I get that corner? Oh well, you know what to do. I'm doing the worst possible job here, but you need to
ask. So anyways, if you're doing a more precise job with this.
Yeah, do a better job than I'm doing.
You would just
for
add
goodness
that little
sake,
bit of
this
space.
Is awful. But you see that it can be done.
It's starting to get a little better.
It's only marginally, I can tell you.
Yeah.
I'm not feeling up to snuff today, so. Anyway, you see how it, see that little bit of air though? I mean, it's a rotten job, I'll give you that. But even that little, everything bad is going on here. Hold on. Why will it not let me clone from there to here? There we go. And here, over to there. All right. Do you see how that little space in front makes all the difference in the world? That's what you need. All right, moving on.
All right.
Let's do another couple. We got some winners coming up. Rodeo. All right, oh, 5 points for capturing the peak moments of action.
Good. That's a peak moment of action.
Peak moment of action. Now,
and that's the strongest one of all of them.
Hands down, the strongest one. Look at the height and everything. The only thing that would make this better is to have the background out of focus.
Yeah.
Now, unfortunately, I can't tell how close they are to the background, but I think you could have used an f-stop like f2.8 or f4 or something to get that background more out of focus and zoom in a little. You don't need all these cowboys in there.
Yeah, you could buck some of those cowboys right out of there.
Yeah, it's funny. I see what you did there. But you know what? You don't want to lose any height.
Yeah, that's the problem.
Yeah, you kind of. Anyway, this is a great shot. And but if I had to nitpick it, I would love to see that background a little more out of focus. Same thing here. Peak moment of action, like you're nailing the action stuff. But can I tell you something? When I look at this shot, what's the first thing you say? What's the first thing you see, Eric?
Hot dogs.
Hot dogs, absolutely. If there's text in a photo, we are programmed to read it. So if that background was out of focus, we wouldn't see hot dogs. We would see the rider. So that's why you got one thing to do. First off, you're nailing the peak moment of action, which is so hard for so many people. But you got to get that background out of focus.
Yeah, I mean, that's even good. I mean, what would be perfect if those tassels weren't flying into the face there and you saw the face of the rider.
Oh, yeah, but you know what?
That's hard. That's sports photography right there.
It's still a good shot.
It's still good.
But so you got one thing to work on because you know what it is? You've nailed the hard part.
Yeah, yeah.
The moment of action. You got to go fix the easy part.
You didn't just take the picture of the referee when...
Go take a picture of the referee's butt. Here we go. Referee's butt, a referee's butt. Okay. So, you know what these are? They're all right.
They're cute shots.
They're okay.
But
now, here's one thing that you can do to make them a whole lot better. What you're missing here in two of the three shots is the closeness and the connection. Their heads are apart. This is what, a mother, mm-hmm. a daughter, and the kid. You lean their heads in towards each other. You get rid of that gap and you create a whole different level of closeness and attachment. It just would change everything. Yeah. That one thing, lean this head this way, this head a little that way, close that gap or minimize that gap, and this would just be a whole lot better. Same thing with this one right here. Get the mom's head closer to the baby, get them both there. That would help. Now, there's other things. She's got a thumb, like a disembodied
thumb
there.
Rogue thumb.
What did you say?
Rogue thumb.
Rogue thumb.
Take out the rogue thumb.
Take out the rogue thumb. What's just disembodied thumb helping? So let's get you in nice and tight.
Boom.
So look, you got bright area up there. That's not helping you whatsoever.
Right there.
All right, get the baby and the mom's heads closer together. It's just gonna look a lot better. The skin tones are kind of funky. The light isn't awesome, and it's kind of dark there. What are we gonna do to fix this? What if we let's just brighten the exposure a little bit. Let's go in here and brighten up that little area.
You're also able to add just a little bit of a vignette.
Yep, a little vignette. Let's get the baby's forehead there a little bit. Let's get some, the color's just not awesome either. We could warm it up a bit, I think would make everybody's, that's selective, that's, hold on, sorry. I need to get out of this and back to the basic. You know, they made this thing work more like Lightroom. except for I'm stuck on selective edits. It's horrible. Get me out of here. Just... There's no way to get out of here. You're stuck in it for the rest of your life. Here we go.
There we
go. Make it a little warmer. And like Eric said, scroll down. Oh, I'm also in a bad mode here. I need to be in single panel mode. There we go. Which is solo mode for Lightroom users. And luckily that Adobe didn't name them the same thing. That helps.
Yep, there it is, vignette.
That's vignetting. Is it? Hold on. There you go. Kind of put the emphasis on them. And let's see a before and after. Oh, well, you can see that one. Let's just, can we see an overall before and after? So see how the skin tone is warmer? It's not so bluish. Now that's not giving you a full before and after. That's just giving you a kind of a partial before and after. Because we cropped
it's after the crop. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and
but
you
even
have
pulling
the
in tighter,
baby's
sculpting
face
that light
is brighter. Yeah, it's there, but they're all okay. But I think you can certainly can do better. All right.
All right.
Holy cow! It's time for the next break. So. Coming up next, we're going to name our prize winners. We got winners for a Platypod Max, a Elytra 2.0, the Slick Pick Master Level Membership. We got 5 book winners. It's all coming up here in just a minute. And more images right after the break.
This segment of The Grid is brought to you by Platypod, the world's most compact tripod base.
Make sure you don't miss any episodes of The Grid by subscribing to Apple's podcast app or iTunes. It's free, and we even have a special audio-only version, too. So sign up today.
Hey, we're back. Scott's here with Eric, and we're doing blind critiques. Let's get some winners, Mr. Kuna.
Yeah, we got winners of our contest. So Gail D., you've won the Platypod Max. And then Jessica Sievers, you've won the Elytra 2.0 Lite. And then the slick pick is Lisa Krause. And then the book, we have 5 winners. So we've got Stefan Christophus, Hugh Williams, Karen Choi, and then Pernell O and Carmen. You've all won the ebook. If you want to just email gridprize@kelby1.com. And we'll get you your prize. So gridprize@kelby1.com will verify your information and send out your prizes.
Also, don't forget, if you did not win the Slick Pick Master Level account, you can get 50% off. Mm-hmm. Go to slickpick.com/kelby1. You get half off. That's
you know, and we talked about that last week when you were out, Scott, is one of our members that won got the master level account. One of the things with the master level account is they actually have a designer work with you
on
your portfolio. And the person had their portfolio already up in like just a couple days later.
Wow. So. Sorry I missed that.
Yeah.
All right. So, So, in the interest of time, because the show ended 5 minutes ago, we're going to do what's called a lightning round.
Lightning round.
So we're going to hit maybe seven or eight more, but 1 minute apiece.
Just all right,
real
let's
quick.
Do this.
Boom, boom, boom. Ready?
Yep.
Hit the timer, Mr. Kuna, and let's go. All right. Overall, very creepy.
Yeah, definitely.
It's creepy as heck. However, you pulled it off. You're pulling off what? You know, I don't know what the symbolism is, or if this is like a virus thing, or
It definitely looks like that, because it looks like they're class 2020. They got some kind of like gas mask on.
But they're pulling it off.
They're definitely pulling it off.
It's just very creepy. So good job. You're doing good with your flash and your colors and different stuff. So. That's pretty good for a creepy thing. Here we go. 1 minute.
Yosemite. Plane.
Well, these are all nice.
Yeah.
Looks like Yosemite. Very nice.
Yeah.
That's a really nice shot.
That's a nice shot.
I see a lot of people take shots of this particular place. This is from a like an overlook.
Yep.
And that's very nice. You got great dramatic clouds. I like the lighting. It's very nice. This is nice. I like that it's not straight on and too predictable. That's just nice. Was that a Mustang? I'm not sure what that is. It's very nice, though. And this is the least favorite because you're 100% on the sky.
You're a little crooked, too.
Yeah, a little crooked, but you're 100% on the sky. Want to make this better? Here we go. Because since you're leaning up fully on the sky, what happened here? I thought I opened this in Photoshop. I guess it is open. Oh, no. Here we go. All right. I'm going to run over for 1 second. Here we go. Let's make this better. We're going to cheat to make it better, but this one is crooked. It needs cheating. Why don't you see my selection? Come on, Photoshop.
Yeah, we're having problems today. You're not even, your selection isn't even showing up.
All right, let me quit it real quick.
Yeah,
hang on, everybody.
Relaunch.
Let me relaunch. You can go off that screen there for a second. Hello?
So we're back over here.
Go to
maybe.
Eric.
Cut to me.
Anybody in the control room, hit the button that makes
there
Eric
we are.
Come up.
There we are. So anyways, we're going to reboot Photoshop here because that sometimes happens, you know? And that's the key. If you have Photoshop, it's acting up. Something's not
working. It'll be fine. We restart.
Just restart. It happens. Happens to all of us.
Does it, though?
I don't know. It happens to me. Happens to Scott. Happens to
all right,
a lot
here
of people
we go.
I know.
Let's try it again. Yeah, there's our
there it
selection.
Is. It came back.
All right, here's how we're going to fix it. We're going to duplicate the top half of the image from the water line up. We're going to flip it upside down. We're going to drag it straight down. Whoa, that image just got a whole lot more interesting.
Yeah, it did.
But we're also going to go add a little bit of motion blur. Not that much.
Perfect.
Not in that direction. Just a little bit of motion blur so it's not so obvious. And then we're going to darken that thing a little bit. So it's not so obvious. And that's a whole lot more interesting photo than that. Look, when you're banking on the sky and there's nothing else going on, your only hope is a reflection. Okay.
All right.
But good stuff overall. Just that last one's kind of meh. All right, 1 minute, Eric. Hit it.
Yep, got it. Go.
Oh, these are kind of small. Let me open them in Camera Raw because they're too small.
Yeah.
Ooh, I like that one. You know what your problem is? All of your photos are underexposed.
Yeah, I was gonna
let me
say
just
the
show
thing.
You. Here, I can fix this photo in 5 seconds. Here's what we got to do. First, why isn't it fitting on screen? There we go. Watch this.
It's just,
ready?
It's just
watch.
Very underexposed.
Super easy. Duplicate the layer. Change the blend mode to screen. Done. Look at the difference. You could even do it again. Duplicate that same layer. And now you got a shot. That's it. Your photography's good, but man, your stuff is underexposed like a boss. Like,
yeah,
go brighten everything up.
Two stops.
Two stops least. Underexposed at least. All right, let's move on. Good. Your photography's good though.
Mm-hmm.
Your exposure's bad. Here we go. I swear I've got that ceiling someplace. That could be Cuba. These are nice. I like them.
Yeah. Yeah.
That one's the least. You know what it is? It's a cityscape, but it's just kind of, man, I mean, it's all right. It's like, yep, that's my hometown. There it is. It's all right.
Yeah.
I like that one the best. Because I love the contrasting colors. And I like the perspective. They're okay. Not bad. Not wow. Just okay.
All right.
Here we go. 1 minute.
Got it.
All right. Photographically, you've pulled off all of these well. They're all photographically pulled off well. Mm-hmm. It's just, this is okay. You got nice leading lines. It's okay. This is very nicely done. So this is in Rome. It's the what? Pantheon? It's not the Parthenon. I think it's the Pantheon.
Yeah.
And it's hard to get a good shot of it, and I think you did. So that's my favorite of the three. I'm a sucker for spiral staircases, but this one's not really doing much for me. I think you got a real winner here. This is all right. But, like, you nailed all the technical. I mean, you know your camera stuff.
Yeah.
I would just search for a little more interesting subjects, but overall, not bad. All right. We're getting down to the end here. Here we go. One. Two, three very nice shots.
Mm-hmm.
The first one, I really like this one, except for the propeller stuff. Go get Moose Peterson's book. What's his book called? Takeoff?
Takeoff, yeah.
Takeoff. Go get Moose Peterson's book. He'll give you the exact shutter speed to get that nice prop blur. You got a little bit of prop blur. You need... Boy, if you had the nice round plop, if you had the nice, that really nice round, you would have a killer. That's all that's standing between you and that is the right shutter speed. But that's nice. And look at the space they left for the plane to fly in. It's perfectly composed.
Well, and
you
the
are
plane's tilting into the light. Like you did a lot of good stuff.
Oh, dude, you got
right
everything
here.
Going on here, but the right prop blur. That's nice, and you got room for the bird to fly, and it's very sharp. This is really nice. Can I tell you what I like about your photography? Your tones are very similar.
Yeah.
You're going with kind of a bluish thing. You like that, and you're drawn to it, and I think you're doing a nice job with it. Very nice. Really great, like, composition on this last one. All right. 1 minute, Mr. K.
Yep, got it.
Here we go. Let me open them up in camera raw. They're not opening up big enough. These are nice.
Yeah.
You know what's nice? Look at the
light
coming.
I love the light coming in there. And like.
That's nice. Yeah. Nicely composed. You got a foreground. You got a middle ground. You got a sky in the background. It's a nice sky. This is very nicely composed. You've got depth in the photo.
Yeah, like that's how to use like a window arch like that.
Yep. And this is very different, but very nicely done. Good job. Good job.
Mm-hmm.
Sound like I'm talking to my dogs. Good job. Good job.
Awesome.
We've already done that one, and last one. Here we go. All right, you have one spectacular shot.
Yes, that one.
That's freaking money, cover of an animal book. The lighting is great, the expression, the eyes, and everything. Now, I will tell you this. All three of your shots are slightly out of focus. I don't know if that's the quality of what you sent me. I'm hoping the originals are really sharp, but I can only go by what you sent me. They're all kind of soft.
It's Especially, you can notice in the eyes, you know, especially in the first one was...
This one's not nearly as good. You got a great expression, but the background's not out of focus. This one's okay, but gorillas aren't blue. Let's go to your color temperature and make him a grayish. There you go. That would help there. And that's not bad. It's not awesome, but man... You got one shot that you better be, if that thing is actually sharp, you better be entering that contest.
Yeah, that middle one is, that's money.
That's, that backlit, forget it. That, you better be entering that one in contests. All right, we have completely wrapped up. We're way over time. But I want to thank you guys for watching today. I want to thank all of our sponsors. We couldn't do without you guys. I want to thank my crew here who are all experts at social distancing. So thanks to Christina, who is moderating our comments today. Thanks to Ron, who is our streaming monster. And thanks to Jason, who's in the booth switching like a boss. And thanks to all of you for watching. On behalf of myself and the real man, Rocket Man, Canaham, loves to eat Spam.
I don't mind Spam. I don't mind Spam. It's good.
Lives in a foreign land.
Yes.
I've run out of things.
Yep.
Uses rubber bands. Mr. Kuna.
All right. Thanks, guys. Thanks for tuning in.
Thanks, everybody.
We'll see you next week.
Tell your friends 11 a.m. is our new time on Wednesdays. We'll catch you next week. Take care, everybody.
See you, guys.
I've got a question for you. What would your creative life be like if you were really good at Photoshop? I mean, imagine the things that you could do, the images you'd be able to create. Everybody wants to learn Photoshop because it's the pro's tool. It's their secret weapon. And you can do anything with Photoshop. And when I'm out there teaching, one of the most common things I hear is, you know, yeah, I would love to get good at Photoshop. I mean, I use it now and then, but I'm just not that really sure what I'm doing. I also hear from people who do use Photoshop pretty regularly, but they're kind of stuck at a plateau of learning. And if they just had some time to dig in and really learn the latest stuff, they know how it would change everything for them. What if, in just 2 days, you could really unlock the power of Photoshop? You could take a big leap forward in your skills and start doing those things in Photoshop that you've only dreamed of. If you had the right instructors and your choice of classes, and you could do this all from home in your own environment where you're already comfortable and you have everything you need, there's no telling how far you could go in just that short time. Well, now that we actually have the time, we've got a way for you to supercharge your Photoshop skills and take things to the next level in just 2 days. It's a totally live, online, interactive learning experience produced and hosted by the folks who bring you Photoshop User Magazine. We're the same people who've been producing the annual Photoshop World Conference since back in the 1990s. And today, we're launching a new live Photoshop online learning experience, and we want you to be a part of it. Come and join us for the Kelby One Photoshop Conference. It's a live 2-day multi-track conference, and it's delivered completely online. So no matter where you are in the world, you can be a part of it. We brought together some of the best Photoshop instructors in the world, including trainers like Terry White, Serge Romilly, Mark Heaps, Adobe's own Brian O'Neill Hughes, Tracy Sweeney, Glenn Dewis, Victoria Pavlov, along with the editor of Photoshop User Magazine and the author of the best-selling book, How Do I Do That in Photoshop? That's me, by the way. Anyway, you're gonna learn a lot about Photoshop. You're gonna learn more about Photoshop in 2 days than you ever thought you could. This is accelerated learning, but it's presented in a way that makes it fast and easy to learn. You can so do this, and we're there to make sure you can. Plus, you'll have exclusive on-demand access to the entire conference afterward, so you can go back and rewatch any session again or the sessions that you might have missed during the entire 2-day event. So, what if you're brand new to Photoshop? Then you can come and join us the day before the conference for a Photoshop crash course to get you up and running fast so you can feel comfortable during the event. It's short, sweet, and to the point, but it will get you comfortable with how Photoshop works so you can make the most of the next 2 days. Plus, we have classes for beginners during the conference that will get you using Photoshop like a pro in no time. We'll also have late night sessions on the best Photoshop plugins, one-on-one Q&A sessions with our instructors, and lots of fun surprises along the way. Best of all, we've made this entire conference super affordable, so anybody, anywhere can join in. So come spend a few days with us, focusing on something really positive, on being creative, on growing your skills, and getting totally immersed in learning, laughing, and supercharging your Photoshop skills. You can sign up right now for the Photoshop Conference at KelbyOneLive.com, and we'll see you July 14th and 15th, 2020, as the world's best come together for this unique Photoshop learning experience. We'll see you there.